London.
Why do birds suddenly appear every time you are
chance for me to talk to two gentlemen who have been more responsible for my neighbours smashing on the walls than I think anybody else, any two other people, with the possible exception of Stockhausen and Vorjak. But that's because they're the kind of people you want to play loud, and it was only recently I discovered stereo cans. It's a sad reason to have the chance to talk with half of one of the most successful pop acts, if that's the right word, in the world, because as you heard in the news, as you saw in the papers, Karen Carpenter of the Carpenters has been taken ill, and Richard earlier this week did a flying visit, literally a flying visit to London, to explain and to talk to the people. Right now I'm sitting at the press reception for that very thing, and Richard brought with him the guy who does a lot of the, he's got a thing around his neck which says words, John Bettis, who is the lyricist, rushing around taking pictures. John, it literally is a flying visit, isn't it?
Yeah, we'll only be here about 7 hours. Yeah, and so we won't even feel the jet lag. We'll be back before we even know. We lost Thursday. We have no idea where Thursday went at all. But we had to come, and I'm glad we did, because it was necessary, I think.
Around your neck, you have an ID tag which just says word.
Right, that was a present from Rich and Karen last Christmas. And actually, on the other side, it says, love, Richard and Karen. Because I get lost. And they know that if it says words and love, there's only one Karen and Richard that anybody knows about. So they'll return me by return post.
Please find our lyricist. Do you lose many lyricists, Richard?
Not yet, but we don't want to lose John.
Let's get the heavy question out of the way, first of all. How is Karen?
Karen is really in a state of mostly physical exhaustion, and is recovering very slowly from a couple of ladies' illnesses.
Mm-hmm.
It's
something which is just a case of time, tender loving care.
Yes, TLC and time.
Because whenever somebody hears, you know, the tour's cancelled, Karen's ill, everybody gets terrible visions of, you know, oh, you know, they're all panicking, and how serious is it? It's just tiredness, exhaustion, and the spin-offs from that.
Medication and a good diet, and especially nothing but rest. It's nothing terminal, it's just something that rest is going to take care of.
Because John was saying that you've been working like 340 days in the year or something ridiculous.
Yeah, it between the touring and the album, especially Horizon, took longer than all of them. Probably because we're worn out. Mm. I mean, we've been going since 70, and we love performing, we love recording, but it just takes longer and longer to record and to come up with ideas, because you really tire up. It takes a lot out of you.
Now, the kickoff in 70, I suppose Ticket to Ride was the real breaker.
Yeah, it did fairly well in the States. It was on the charts for several months. The one that really did it, though, as far as the touring and everything, was Close to You. That's the one that went to number one and sold a couple of million copies, and that's when the demand started.
Herb Alpert was very involved in the launch of your career.
Yes, he was. He was the person who signed us to his label based on our demo tape, and I feel he was responsible for a hell of a lot right there. And then a year later, he comes along with the idea of me doing an arrangement of Close to You and us recording it. And so I feel that Herb was responsible for two very important things. A record contract and Close to You.
And you've always been with the same record company?
Yeah, we've always been with A&M.
Never done a switch. The new album, Horizons, I noticed has got... We've had a lot of songs that the two of you, yourself and John, have written, but there's one that John wrote.
The one he wrote with Tony Peluso.
Guitar player and bad disc jockey, if I remember.
Well, it's a matter of opinion. Some people said bad and some people really liked it, but...
No, I'm being facetious. He did the kind of cruising links
on the Now and Then album. He's laid up, just got out of the hospital, by the way, not to get into a different subject, but he busted his leg up in a motorcycle accident. Tony and a gal named Diane Rubin and John wrote a song called Happy on the album, and John also wrote most of the lyrics to another tune by Palma Pascal, who is an unknown who sent us a tape of songs called Love Me For What I Am. And then, was there anything else other than the rest of it you and I wrote?
Let's go and talk to words while Richard rushes off to be pictured. Let's have a listen to Happy first. Happy, written by yourself and Tony, the guitar player, with the backing group.
Right.
You were telling me before we started recording, in fact, that there were lyrics to that song.
Right. Actually, Richard heard it from Tony. Tony had made some... best way to put it is demos on a home studio that he had. And he was playing it out on the road tour to the distraction of everyone. And Richard heard this one song called Happy. And he liked it very much. And especially like the overall effect of the song with the guitars. And he heard a lot of ARP in it. And like on the record, you'll hear a lot of ARP and a lot of very percussive things. It's kind of a different record. And he loved the hook. And I loved the hook. But the verses really didn't fit together right. And he asked me if I'd rewrite it. And rewrite the lyrics. And I said, meh, sure. It's always Richard that finds the songs if I'm going to rewrite or become involved with a song with another composer on the Carpenters albums. Because he's the final word, really, on what's going to go on the albums.
How long have you been writing with Richard, John?
8 years. We started out at Long Beach State together. Well, many, many years. A lot of songs, too.
Yeah.
A lot of songs. We've probably written 40 or 45 songs by now. Most of them have been recorded. Some of them haven't. Some of them weren't very good, is the reason they haven't been recorded. I hope now we will be writing more often and be searching out some different areas for ourselves to write. We really like to write a standard country ballad. That's been a dream of ours since Top of the World. Because Top of the World was like an up-tempo, happy country song. And we'd really like to write an End of the World together, a country standard. We'd love that. And then I think we'd like to write the next single, too, if we can.
But Top of the World is obviously one of your favorite songs that they've done.
Oh, yeah. It really is. It's got a funny story behind it. The first summer tour I ever went out on with them was, I think, in 1972. And tour one. And they were traveling around two Lear jets. And I had spent about a month and a half in Nashville, Tennessee, studying the way country writers write, because I've always admired, especially the lyrics of country writers, because country music is really a lyricist's format. The music is, in some cases, very beautiful. It's not really innovative. It's not as far-reaching as rock music is today. But I caught up with them in Nashville, and I went on the road with them for 3 weeks, and they were traveling around the Lear jet. And well, Richard got a kick out of it, too, is we took out of the airport on the Lear jet, right? It's like he had told the pilot to go up as fast as he could and do a belly roller, or BR as they call it, as we go up and the drinks and everything fly in the air. And that was one of those rare moments where you look around, and I looked at Richard and he was grinning like a Cheshire cat. And he looked at me and
probably his millionaire time.
Right. He said,
yeah.
We made it. And I said, right. And Top of the World came from that. The chorus idea.
Yeah.
Top of the World looking down on creation, and the only explanation I could find. It's a love song, actually, from me actually to Rich and Karen. That's the emotion that I centered on to find the verses, to be honest with you. That's where it came from. So it's a special song to us.
It's a super song, Top of the World.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
It really is, because you're getting to that country feel. But without it being the terrible Bring on the Dobros and the terrible... I always find country singers, it's all doom and despondency most of the time. You write happy songs.
Well, we try to. Sometimes Richard and I will, like, Goodbye to Love is not a really cheery song. Country music is an interesting phenomenon. It's one of the truly American forms. Like, blues is a typically American form. Rock really is not American anymore, in my opinion. Rock has become so worldwide, and Britain, this country, has had so much to do with it, that it'd be very hard to say it was an American phenomenon any longer. With the phenomenal rock and roll groups that Britain has turned out, I don't know whether America has the ownership of rock anymore. I think it's a worldwide phenomenon, you know? But with country music, first of all, it's a lyricist, as I was saying before, it's a lyricist's heaven. Because you're supposed to be inventive, you're supposed to tell a story, you're supposed to be tender, which with Karen's voice is heaven. You're supposed to be tender with a voice that is that warm, that reaches across the speakers like that for you. As I was saying before, the country ballad we'd like to write, I am sure, will be a sadder song, like Into the World, right? And it will be, I hope, God willing, sometime in the next 3, 5, 50 years, whenever Richard and I can come up with it, we'd like nothing better than to have like a country standard that lives like an End of the World. Or some of the Willie Nelson songs, like Funny How Time Slips Away, you know? Or Hello There. Great writer. I'd like to write one song that lasted like some of Willie Nelson's songs. And I know Richard can do it, so I guess it's kind of up to me.
I'm done at 29 minutes to 10. Thank you, Huge. Talking with Richard Carpenter and the man who writes the words, John Bettis. Whenever you look at an album sleeve from a Carpenter's album, there are a selection. There's your own material, there's other people's material. You said that the final word is with Richard, but obviously if you're working together as a team, this is the first time we've met. I met Karen and Richard the last time over, and it's obviously a happy team thing or a very, very well-preserved phony front, and I don't think anybody can keep it up that well.
Thank you. No, it's not a phony front. Richard and I, a long time ago, in the formative days of the group, back when I was with him and first was with him and the group got put together, learned together about how to write songs. And I've always believed that as you learn how to write songs, you develop an appreciation of other people's material. And once that instinct or that feeling or that appreciation is developed within yourself, it's foolish to ignore it because it nurtures your own talent. The only time that I would like to see an album that Richard and I wrote the entirety of would be if all of those songs were superlative to any other song we could find. If I hear a song that's better, that, for instance, there was a song we were going to put on the last album that Richard and I had worked on. To be honest, neither one of us was really on the floor about how good it was. And Richard found I Can Dream, Can't I? He got taken away with the arrangement. I fell in love with it, and it got on the album. And to be honest with you, I am happier that I Can Dream, Can't I is on the Horizon album than I would be if the song that we had worked on at that time were on it.
Karen has an amazing plaintive voice at times, but she's capable of so many different things. I think Richard's singing ability sometimes gets ignored and overshadowed by people like myself who play records on the wireless. Do you ever feel that the time will come for a Richard Carpenter solo album? I should ask him that, really, but they dragged him off for photographs.
Yeah, it would be better. That would be... We've talked about that, okay? It's a very, very, very slim chance, right? Very slim chance. There are some things that Richard is capable of doing that probably deserve an album. But maybe we have a unique way of looking at albums. I think Richard and I both hold the opinion that Karen is a magic natural resource, right? That voice just, the first time I heard it, spring out of her mouth. I fell in love with it. And I don't see any need at this point, myself. I'm speaking for myself. I can't speak for Richard. I don't see any need right now for a solo album. There's so many directions in which Richard and Karen, and hopefully me along with them, and Tony and everybody, can go.
And so many things we have yet to learn, so many songs we have yet to write. So many, Karen is only 25 years old. And she shows no inclination of even standing still.
Which is why, sadly, she's ill, I think.
Precisely. She's got more energy than I do, for sure. For sure. She can run me into the ground, you know. But no, I don't see that in the future. I really don't.
I mean, Richard has done solo tracks on past albums, mm-hmm. including that lovely piano picker and the flat baroque piano solo.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was then that I realized how good a pianist Richard Carpenter actually is.
Nor do they make real superstars or personalities out of arrangers, okay? And Richard is one of the superlative arrangers alive today. Secondly, producing. Richard Perry is not a superstar. George Martin really isn't a superstar. Glenn Johns isn't a superstar. Bill Skimzik isn't really a superstar at this point. And it's a shame that the public doesn't reserve some sort of celebrity status for those people who are so technically good, like Richard is. I think he fits in that company. Thirdly, in an area that I think that he probably will attain a celebrity status, is as a writer. Because in my opinion, I write with him, so maybe I'm prejudiced, but he's probably one of the best 5 or 10 alive right now.
Who would you put in with the other 4 or 9?
Oh, boy.
Is that an unfair question?
No, that's fine. Don Henley and Glenn Frey are probably at the top of the list right now. David Gates, when he was healthy, when he was making good records, is an amazing writer. Paul Simon is probably one of the best writers alive today. Paul McCartney, when he gets his lyrics together, is, as a total songwriter, a great writer. He suffers a little bit from a lack of John Lennon, I think, on the lyric plane, because he's not the lyricist Lennon was. Lennon is an amazing lyricist. Oh, boy. Who else today?
That's a pretty good kickoff. And, of course, Carpenter and Bettis. Mustn't forget that.
Carpenter, maybe.
But it's important. Surely your contribution is very important. Do you, when you're writing, and basically you're writing lyric, I think, and Richard writes the music, do you write the lyric with things like the fact that Richard is a good producer and therefore you can get as many different vocal lines as you like in mind?
It's possible. During Horizon, we sophisticated and enlarged our writing relationship. I first of all rewrote a lot more things than I had in the past, especially on those 2 songs we talked about before. Secondly, Richard and I worked much more closely on, for instance, Only Yesterday. We worked at Only Yesterday as a record as well as a song. In other words, he would sit me down and say, look, I need these vocal sounds here and here and here. I've always had, God bless me with a talent or whatever, I have an ear for vocal sounds where they should go. Richard, like for the last 8 years, has nurtured that and brought it out of me and given me an understanding. He and Frank Cooler gave me an understanding of what vocal sounds are really like, which is like, for instance, Paul Williams has an ability to do that naturally. Okay? I may have had that, but I was lucky enough to have people nurture that in me. So I progressed kind of fast that way. But with writing the way it is now, with Horizon, I wrote some lyrics first, like Caught Between Goodbye and I Love You. I wrote the hook to that first, and then the verses came later. With Only Yesterday, I wrote the complete music first, and then I applied the lyrics to that. Aurora and Eventide, we kind of did together, and it just kind of happened in the studio. We needed... Richard had that piano line, and I think he was kind of insecure about it. And he was going through it, and he knew he had a melody in there. But he wasn't sure if he wanted to put it on a record, because it's always a choice.
Yeah.
You may have a melody that you like, but do you really want to put it on a record? Do you really think that people want to hear that, or is it just something you want to have for yourself? Eventually, like, I got so excited about it, and I think Kieran got excited about it, that he let his enthusiasm show through. And we wrote Aurora and Eventide, like, in the studio, like, bang. So it works all kinds of different ways nowadays. We've written together long enough that it doesn't fall into one format, because we can work in a lot of different ways, an awful lot of different ways.
Aurora and Eventide are unlikely, even for the Carpenters, although you, between you and I always think, I'm now starting to think of it as you, as much as Richard and Karen as being part of the Carpenters, because it is obviously
a corporate team thing. Each unit helps the other, and it kind of clicks together. When do they release your album?
No. No, I'm a writer. I'm a writer. I've wanted to be a writer like since I was six, and I want to be a writer until I'm 60.
So you won't do one?
Most seriously doubt it.
I'll ask the boss, his return. I was just asking when John's first solo album will be released.
That was saying never.
A wry laugh from Richard. A wry laugh from Richard.
I don't know what John's plans are in that direction.
What about you? Any plans for a solo Richard Carpenter album?
Mm-mm. No, we have enough to do with the Carpenters, really. I like to spend a lot of time in the studio getting things just right for us, and it takes all the time we have.
I know you've got very little time now, but we have to rush off to the airport and back home to the West Coast.
Yeah, well, if the fog lifts, I guess we'll be off.
Well, the news is in, Richard, that your plane is down, so you'll be back heading home.
Oh, really?
Yep.
It's landed.
Oh, terrific.
So you'll be back on the beach before the jet lag hits. Would you give Karen all our love from all of your fans?
I most certainly will. Yeah, and we want to really say the same thing. I mean, I was just talking with some other people here that... And saying that I really wouldn't have wanted to stay home and just send a statement. I really wanted to come over and do it personally because we're really upset about having to miss a day, never mind the whole tour. And we will be back. And we really want to thank everybody who's been so nice to us.
Thanks for coming, Richard. Thanks for taking time to talk to us.
Sure.
Love to Karen. See you. 76?
76.
And also my thanks to John Bettis, who I've just discovered is 21 today, again.
Yeah, right. Thank you very much.
No two people should have that much talent and look that good, however. The Carpenters.